He says, has not the Lord made them one? Well, I'll back it up. He says, another thing you do, you flood the Lord's altar with tears. You weep and wail because he no longer pays attention to your offerings and accepts them with pleasure from your hands. You ask why? It's because the Lord is acting as the witness between you and the wife of your youth. Because you have broken faith with her, though she is your partner, the wife of your marriage covenant. Has not the Lord made them one? In flesh and spirit they are his. And why one? Because he was seeking godly offspring. So guard yourself in your spirit and do not break faith with the wife of your youth. I hate divorce, saith the Lord God of Israel, and I hate a man's covering himself with violence as well as with his garment, saith the Lord Almighty. So guard yourself in your spirit and do not break faith. He says, I'm judging you because you're divorcing your wife and trading her in most of the time for younger heathen women, young pretty women who are heathens. You trade in the wife of your youth, the one you married when you were young. You got older and trading her in for this heathen now. And he said, I had cut the covenant with you to have godly offspring and to keep the lineage genetically pure. You worship me, your wife worship me, and your offspring were taught to worship me. And then when you mix in the seed of a heathen or an idolater, then the kid is now thrown into this realm where they're worshiping idolatrous gods, and the bloodline is now blemished and defiled. That's what he's talking about. Mixing the clean with the unclean. You know, the Bible plainly says a bishop must be the husband of one wife. Now, Bishop Weeks is on his third marriage. Nobody flinches. Why? Nobody confronts the truth of things. Folks are marrying and giving in marriage. Paula White jumping around in a pool pit, divorced. I mean, what can you tell me running around with Donald Trump? Come on, man. What is Donald Trump doing in this? Donald Trump? And the people in church sit there crazy, driven into madness. Why? They're not born again believers. We need to stop appending the name born again believer to people who have no character traits of the life type. A born again believer has a character trait and a life type that defines them. If you were born again and you knew instinctively to stop doing certain things, everybody who was born again knows instinctively to stop doing it. Nobody had to tell me to throw away all my old records and CDs and tapes when I was born again. I knew the trash was filthy when I was listening to it, and when I was born again, nobody had to come and tell me, you know, you need to stop listening to that. You knew to throw it away. Now we have to go and teach people that hip-hop is wrong in the church? That's crazy. You have to really teach a born-again Christian that hip-hop is wrong. And then we come with hip-hop has invaded the church. Hip-hop has not invaded the church. Heathens that love hip-hop are just sitting in the church who have never been born again. They need to be born again. Ingrained in the born-again experience is the knowledge of the unclean and the clean. When you are born of God's Spirit, you know you have to stop doing certain things. It's birthed in you. This is a great example of your about being born again and repenting from sin. If I'm a sinner walking full throttle to the west, and I encounter Jesus somewhere along my journey, and he confronts me, and I'm born again, and I repent of my sins, and I'm born again, I turn 180 degrees around and I begin to walk east, away from the direction I was headed, because I'm born again. I use this example a lot of times with sinners who tell me about we're still human and all of us, you know, have frailties and all of us fall short. And I said, let me ask you a question. Using that scenario of walking west and confronted by Jesus and repenting and turning around and walking east, can you simultaneously walk east and west at the same time? Well, no. I said, that's what repentance is. It's turning around from where you were going and turning in the other direction. If I got a boyfriend I'm fornicating with every night and I get born again, tomorrow night I know I can't fornicate with my boyfriend. It's going to be birthed into you. that I cannot do this tomorrow night because I was born again on Wednesday, so therefore Thursday I cannot fornicate. I know that instinctively. Nobody has to tell it to you. Nobody has to convince you. Nobody has to show it to you. It comes in the package. If you tell lies every day, you know you're a liar. You get born again, you know tomorrow morning I cannot lie like that because I'm born again. Now if you do it, conviction will come on you at first. As you do it and you're convicted and you repent and say, I can't do this. I can't keep doing this. See, I mean, that's the leftover remnant of what you were. When you try to do it, God may, you know, he may convict you and come against you at first. If you continue on in, he'll let you go and you're still a sinner. So you're not going to continue on in sin having been born again. Ain't no way. No way on God's green earth. Instinctively birthed into you is the conviction of sin. In any act that you perform outside of God's parameters, you're convicted of sin. You know it's sin. But if you override it through your will, God takes his hands off of you and you go on in that make-believe delusion about yourself being saved, and you're as lost as a ball in high weeds pretending that you're saved and making a fool out of yourself. So you can be driven into madness in this, and you can believe that you're all right. And God will let you believe you're all right and send you to hell, and you'll be standing there wondering why you're going to hell in a delusion that you made up in your own mind. That's scary, but it's the way it is. This is why you got to get for real, real fast in the born-again experience. He says, so guard yourself in your spirit and do not break faith. Guard yourself in your spirit and do not break faith. The Bible says, guard your heart, because out of your heart flows the issues of life. Out of the abundance of the heart, your mouth will speak. You have to put a guard over yourself to make sure you don't break faith, and that you're protecting your spirit and you stay in the spirit, because you're protecting yourself from delusions and having your mind and your soul contaminated by the things of the world, because you got that safeguard over you to protect yourself from the delusions. If you have wearied, the Lord with your words. How have we wearied him, you ask? By saying, all who do evil are good in the eyes of the Lord, and he is pleased with them, or where is the God of justice? So how you weary God? Looking at a person doing evil, participating in evil, and no confrontation. So now you get Steve Harvey on TBN telling you he's a Christian, and that all of us are God's children, and we should stop being so judgmental and accept the people in the world and their secular life, because God works in every avenue of life, and nobody in that whole arena can tell Steve Harvey, man, sit yourself down and shut your mouth. You don't know nothing about this. They have the platform, they have the stage, and they are actually now dictating to so-called church people about God as a sinner. T.D. Jakes brings sinners to town in a mega fest to entertain church folk, but they're just religious, unsaved people. You got to understand now, halfway between active participation in sin that is evident, a murderer, usually look at a murderer, a mass murderer, a killer, or a serial killer, and all these people, they're the sinners. Halfway between those prototypes, a gangland member, somebody you can look at and say that Hitler is evil, he's of the devil. And the Christian that's sanctified and holy before God is this pseudo-Christian that has the heart of the world but tries to look like they're godly. That's the worst case scenario. That's the person that you better mark as the most evil of all. Because they won't admit the filth they are. They try to cover it over as if I'm righteous. And man, if you can't pick one of them out, you'll be swept away by delusion. But you can always tell about them because what? They love the world. They still have an affiliation with the world and the things of the world. They cannot stop participating in the sin because the sin is ingrained in their souls. And I'm going to show you how, man, this thing here is so bad right now because of what's happened to people's minds.